All right, so we're looking at Ephesians chapter 4. I don't remember a time when I've ever spent so long in three verses. And yet this, and really this whole chapter, is so critical to our understanding as Christians. And these three verses in great summary, although as we get a little further on in the fourth chapter, we're going to see a number of really great things. When we get past these three verses, we'll move a little faster for a while, and then when we get to verse 17, we're going to slow back down again. But for now, let me remind you, Paul is writing as a prisoner of the Lord. And he's not saying that figuratively. That's literally what he is. He's in prison for the Lord as he writes this to the Ephesian church. And he says, as a prisoner, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling that you have received. I think it's stunning that he's writing from prison, wanting the Ephesians to understand how important this is. And the idea is a scale. And he says, to walk worthy means that your life matches up completely and identically with what Christ wants for you. So Christ is on one side of the scale, you're on the other, perfect balance. That's the picture here. And he says, if that balance is going to come, these then are the traits that will be true of you. Be completely humble, gentle, patient, bearing with one another in love, making a little effort to keep the unity of... How much? Be a couple weeks before we get to that phrase, but we'll look at that. Every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. So we talked about the fact that there's a scale, God's truth on the one side, my practice on the other. How is the balance taking place? And we see that the first ingredient of this is completely humble. And I'm really struck by that, and we spent many weeks talking about what that looks like. Then we took a little time to look at gentleness or meekness, and that's the second trait. And basically the trait of gentleness or meekness means mild, gentle-hearted, not retaliating, non-vindictive, non-vengeful, not a violent spirit. All right, now we're spending these days on the third ingredient, which is be patient. It's interesting to me that it's the one that I think is ignored the most, because I think most of us would not claim to be experts in patience. Now, I don't know about other cultures, but ours seems to specialize in impatience. Have you noticed? We want it right now. All right, so Ephesians chapter 2, be completely humble, be meek, be patient. And so we're using this definition, especially the last phrase. It's the capacity to accept or tolerate delay, troubles, or suffering without getting angry or upset or complain. Quiet, steady perseverance, long-suffering, or I think this one captures it the best, the gift of joyfully waiting in the Lord. Now, that's not a trait we know a lot about. Byron was talking this morning on how much repentance is not a part of our culture, and I think this one ranks right there up with it, that we don't know much about waiting in the Lord. Matter of fact, it's interesting when you hear people talking about the fruit of the Spirit, many times that's the one word they leave out. When they go through the traits, you know, you're trying to think about, all right, which one, and it seems like this is the one I hear more than any other that's left out. Now, this theme comes up again over and over again in the Scripture. Colossians 3:12 says, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. I wonder, if you look at the people around you today, do you remember next week what they wore to church today? Now, did any of you, when you got up and put on your clothes today, did you ask yourself, did I wear this outfit last Sunday? Okay, so some of you did. I hear some giggles. Now, the one thing I'm really curious about is, would people, as a general rule, say, I remember the people in Voyager's class, clothed with patience? Is this something that characterizes who we are? Now, we're going to see and have been seeing that patience really has two major application areas, one with people, another with circumstances. And we can do fairly well with one and not do well with the other, although often we struggle in both areas. To be patient with people is one kind of thing, to be patient with circumstances is something entirely different. And one of the places where circumstances begin to give us trouble is when there is a trial attached to the circumstance. It isn't just that things aren't going quite well, it's a little more serious than that. So James 5, verses 7 to 11 says, "Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its crop, patiently waiting for the autumn and spring rains. You too be patient and stand firm, because the Lord's coming is near." Now, it's amazing to me, one of the real tests is if you're a patient person or not, is cast by this phrase, "Don't grumble." If we are grumblers, the chances are very good that patience is not something we have under our belt. "Don't grumble against one another, or you'll be judged. The judge who's got himself is standing at the door. As an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophet who spoke in the name of the Lord, and you will know, you will be counted blessed, those who have persevered or have patience. You have heard of Job's perseverance, and you have seen the Lord finally brought about in his life these remarkable things. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy." Or 1 Peter 4, 12 and 14. "Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trials that you come to you to test you, as though something strange was happening to you, but rejoice in as much as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you might be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you're blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you." So when you put these two passages together, what we get is a very good understanding of how we are to face trials in life, joyfully, not being surprised by them. So let's look at some of these traits a minute. What is necessary to be in trial, to live patiently in trial? First one is to expect it. You say, well, okay, we shouldn't be surprised at trials in our lives as Christians, and yet we are. And one of the reasons we are is because in most of our generation, it was fairly acceptable to be a Christian. Matter of fact, if you went into culture and they knew you were a Christian, there were some good sides to that, some benefits to that. That's all going away. Now, more times than not, if you say you're a Christian, that's a detriment. It's a detriment if it comes out in a job interview. It's often a detriment if you're trying to be advanced in a company these days, or even in clubs and among friends. Things have really changed. And most of us are still surprised because we live under the old regime of things. And Scripture said we never should have been surprised because this is what we should expect. Now, the importance for today is it's going everywhere. If you look at any of the things that are going on in the news today, everything is ruling against us. Same-sex marriage, divorce, homosexuality, transgender stuff, all of that stuff cuts against what Scripture says. And if you're going to stand scripturally for any of the things that Scripture says, you're going to be criticized, maligned, perhaps worse than that. That's today. But let's go back into the time in which this was written, and I think it will help us understand how to apply it for today. The setting in 1 Peter is Nero was president. Now, I don't usually make too much apology to say I am absolutely aghast at our current president. I won't go too far with that, but he has done almost everything possible to destroy the morals of this nation. But still, he's nothing compared to Nero. And that's why I want to take just a minute to have you realize when Paul wrote this, this is the context in which he was writing. Nero burned Rome because he wanted to rebuild it. But he knew that he couldn't do that and get away with it, so he blamed it on the Christians. And because of that, it was very uncomfortable to be a Christian. They were hated, accused of cannibalism. You know where that came from? They ate the body and flesh of Jesus. That's communion. They were accused of anarchy because they wouldn't bow to the king. God was their king. And they were accused of being antisocial because they had different standards. Now, does that sound familiar? Yes, of course it does. Christians now were rolled in pitch or oil and set on fire while still alive and used by Nero to light his garden parties. Now, do you know anybody that's had that happen from the current president? Is he light Christians on fire and have a party? No, we don't have it that bad. We really need to understand that. We can start feeling really sorry for ourselves. They were imprisoned, racked. You know what a rack is? You tie them to a Volkswagen and a Ford, and you have a pull to see which is strong. That's kind of a joke, but it's where you're tied at both ends, and then they crank it down, and you're pulled, stretched. You were racked, seared, boiled, burned, scourged, stoned, and hanged. All of those things is what was going on when Peter wrote these verses. So 1 John 3:13 says, don't be surprised if the world hates you. And yet I think we often are because of history. In John 15 and 16 chapters, Jesus says, they hated me, they're of course going to love you. No, if they hated me, they're going to hate you. Or 2 Timothy 3:12, for everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ will be celebrated and honored and will be persecuted. So, don't be surprised. Expect it. Persecution is going to come for righteousness. Now, just listen to this list, and the verses are here for you. You're going to be falsely accused. You're going to be spoken evil of. You are going to endure false accusations. Like, for example, if you make a stand to say what Scripture says about homosexuality, what are you called? A homophobe. That you hate homosexuals. And that's not the case at all. You can be scourged, you will be rejected, you'll be hated by the world, hated by your family, martyrdom. James 1 talks about enduring temptation, shamed for Christ's sake. You see that all over the place now, even from our own president, which is just incredible to me. Tribulations and troubles of all kinds, imprisonment, stonings, beatings, made a spectacle of before men, misunderstood, defamed, despised. Troubles, affliction, distress, tumults, labors, evil reports, all of those things God says we should not be surprised at. So are you? I think we are. We just don't expect that because we have been told God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. And that's why many people become Christians. You become a Christian and everything will go well. That's never what Scripture promised. Scripture said, receive Jesus Christ as Savior, and you will go to heaven, but on earth, you're going to be persecuted. So we ought not to be surprised. 2 Corinthians 4, 7-11, and I love this. It says, we have this treasure, talking about Christ himself, in jars of clay to show that the all-surpassing powers of God and not from us. Now let me go back just a minute. You know what this jar of clay is? It's a bedpan. Now, I'm not being silly. I really am. The Greek word that's used here, they had bedpans because they didn't have open toilets in their homes. And so they would have a chamber pot. And that's what this is. That we're a clay pot, but not just a clay pot. We're a bedpan. All right, so there's the contrast. Now, why are we made bedpans? To show the also passing God powers from God and not from us. Now he goes on and he says then, we're hard pressed on how many sides?
Every side.
But not crushed. Now I love this word, perplexed. Another way to translate it is puzzled. You know what puzzled is? Ruthie does puzzles all the time and it's keeping her mind sharp. You know what a puzzle is? It's a picture that's been cut up in a whole bunch of pieces and tossed into a box. And you can't tell, unless there's a picture on the front of the box, what the puzzle is. One man said, I'm really good at puzzles. He said, it only took me 3 years to put it together. And on the front of the box, it says, 6-year-olds. So you get the idea. So puzzled or perplexed means I can't make sense out of it, but not in despair. Isn't that amazing? I don't really know what's going on. I'm puzzled and perplexed about it, but I'm not in despair. Why? Because I know God is absolutely in charge. I talked to quite a few people about that this week. Do you live without doubt that God is absolutely in charge? Now, I heard about Amy McIntyre this week, and I love Amy. Do you all know who she is? Just one of our very youngest members in her 20s, diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis. That's very serious for all of us, but for a 20-year-old, please tell her we're praying for her, will you? That's very difficult. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. Those four couplets are just profound. But then he says, we once in a while carry around in our bodies the death of Jesus. Oh, okay, you really are antagonist, aren't you, Paul? We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus. Why? So that we could be miserable and awful people. So that the life of Jesus might be revealed in our bodies. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake. So the life of Jesus might also be revealed in our mortal bodies. Do you hear what he's saying there? He says, why can I be patient in trial? Because God's putting me to death so the resurrection power of Christ would take over and reign and rule in me. All right, so a second reason why patience is a part of what we're about is we're not surprised at the fiery ordeal. Now, this is the picture of a smelting furnace. Most of you know that, right? You remember this? They had a big pot, and they built a big fire under it, and then they'd pour metal in it, and it would become molten. And then the refiner would take a ladle and he'd scrape off the impurities that were on the top of the metal. And then he knew the work was done when he saw a clear reflection of his face in the metal. Now that's such a stunning picture. That's the work that God is doing. He says, don't be surprised, because this is the work that God does in us. He is going to put us in the fire to get rid of the impurities for one reason and one reason only. What was it? Wants to see Christ reflected in us. So why can you be patient with this kind of thing? Because you know what God's up to. 1 Peter 1, 6 and 7, and all this you can, how rejoice? Really? Greatly rejoice, though for now, a little while, you'll have to suffer grief of all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith would show, which is a greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, that it may result in the praise, glory, honor of Jesus Christ when he's revealed. So the question is, if our goal is to say, I want Christ to be glorified through me, and the way he does that is I go into the refiner's fire, I'm patient in the midst of it because I see the end product. So do you see where patience plays in God's purpose regarding trials in your life? It's not because he hates you. It's not because he wants you to be miserable. God has a purpose. It's a profound purpose. He says, be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming. And you see, that's the hard part of it, isn't it? I remember my grandfather, Harold Emery, absolutely convinced that Christ would come back before he died. He's been gone a long time. My mom thought she'd see the Lord before she died. That was 14 years ago, I think, if I have my math right. I thought Christ was coming back in the year 2000. It just seemed logical to me. Do you ever get tired of waiting for the Lord's coming? I get impatient for it in a good way But God says if we really understand what God is up to, it'll change everything. So patience under trial comes as we wait and live in the light of the Lord's coming. Romans 8:18, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed. Do you really believe that? Is that just a weird pipe dream that some pastor tells you to make you religious? Do we really believe that? Or 2 Corinthians 4:16-18, therefore we don't lose heart, though outwardly we're wasting away, inwardly we're being renewed day by day. Now this next, for our light and momentary troubles, that's when you know you've got the gift of patience. They're achieving for you an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, what unseen is eternal. When I was with Donna yesterday, and she was definitely close to death, awake, kind of in and out, and I said, Donna, I want you to do two things while you're laying here in the dying process. I want you to think about the past. How has God cared for you? But so what I really want you to do is think about the future. What's it going to be like to see Jesus? Well, let me tell you, there's a sense in which I get just jealous here. Because people are saying, oh, I can't wait to go to heaven because I'm going to see my husband. Or I'm going to see my kids. And I understand all that. But that is so secondary to seeing Jesus. And I will tell you, if that isn't primary for you, you'll never get this. Because seeing Jesus Christ and hear him say, welcome, well done, good and faithful servant, has got to be the most profound thing that's coming. We can be patient because we know that God said in all things they work together for the good, for those who love him are called according to his purpose. Or Philippians 1:6, being confident of this, he who began a good work in you will carry it to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. So how long is patience? Well, Scripture uses this picture. It's like a farmer waiting for the land to yield its valuable crop, waiting for the autumn and the spring rains. If you're in California, that's a long wait. A harvest depends on the providence of God. You realize that? It's amazing to me with all the politicians who just this time of year become kind of nauseating for me, I must admit. They can't do a blasted thing about no rain. They can't do a blasted thing about a whole lot of stuff that they make promises about. It's the providence of God. Do you really believe today that God is absolutely in charge of everything? Now, I think we say yes, but I don't think we live like that. Because if we really lived like that, we're not going to be panicked at elections, at financial downturns, at bad health decisions, about other bad things that come in our lives, because we know the providence of God can be trusted, because this God we trust is good. He never lies. He's never late. Galatians 6:9 says, let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time, catch that, at the proper time. Did you miss that? At the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Now, dear friends, sometimes the waiting for the proper time is not easy. There was a sense of that in Donna's life. And, of course, now the government is stepping in and saying, if you're in the dying process and you don't care about the proper time, you can have an assisted suicide and be done with it. See, even at this point, we can't even die on God's timetable. We're so impatient. In Habakkuk, we've been there so many times, I hope this is an old hat to you. Habakkuk says, how long, Lord? Now that's a legitimate question. That's not impatience. That's a proper concern. How long, Lord, must I cry for help and you don't listen? Now the last half of that isn't correct. The first half is appropriate. I'm struggling, Lord. I need you to do something. But God is listening, and so he gives the answer to Habakkuk in verses 5 and 6. He says, look at the nations and watch and be utterly amazed, for I'm going to do something in your day that you'd never believe, even if you were told. I'm raising up the Babylonians. Now, I love, there were both Chuck Colson and Francis Schaeffer wrote quite a lot about this, if you know them as writers. And one of them, and I can't remember which of the two it was, wrote a book called Here Comes the Barbarians. And it was capturing what was going on in our world back some time ago. Well, that's what this is. Guess who's taking over? Hebrews 3, 16 to 19. So he says, all right, God, you're going to send the Babylonians. This is going to be bad. So I will wait patiently for the what? The day of calamity to come. On the nation invading us. That the Babylonians will eventually be put in their place. But for now, they're going to be used in the hand of God to bring judgment on the nation of Israel. When you look at some of the candidates that we have coming to be our president, the parallels of this are staggering. Though the fig tree does not bud and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no fruit, there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will what? Watch TBN and have them lie to me and say God doesn't want anybody sick, poor, or in trouble. Do you realize, friends, how serious this health, wealth, gospel is? Because it's not what Scripture says. Does God bless? Absolutely. We'll see it in a minute. But what has God promised? That he's going to fulfill his purpose in us. So there it is. No crops, no food, no cattle. So what do? I despair, right? I rejoice in the Lord, he said. I will be joyful in God my Savior. Now, I like the combination of that phrase. I will rejoice in the Lord, he says, but I will be joyful in my Savior. It's a choice. I'm going to give myself to it. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes me feet like the feet of the deer. He enables me to tread on the heights. That's patience in action. So James says, if we looked at it already this morning, consider it pure joy whenever you face trials of many kinds. Well, why? Because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. What's perseverance? It's patience. Let patience finish its work. Why? What does patience accomplish? So that you might be mature, complete, not lacking anything. Now, if you flip that around in the negative, if you want to lack something, you've got to be forever impatient. Because the only way you're going to get everything is you have to be patient for it. A third thing that's critical here for us to live this way is we have to be patient in trial because it brings with it great reward. 1 Peter 4, 13 and 14, but rejoice in as much as you participate in the sufferings of Christ so that you may be overjoyed when the glory is revealed. If you were insulted because of the name of Christ, you're blessed. For the spirit of the glory and of God rests on you. I've often said that one of the greatest compliments is to be criticized by people who hate God. Matter of fact, I would even say that sometimes more is said of us about our critics than about those who applaud us. Because some of the critics that put us down are really a compliment because they're so opposite to what God is saying. Do you feel blessed when you're in the midst of trial? Well, that's what Scripture is inviting us to do. Matthew 5, 10 and 11, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness. Scripture makes a big distinction between suffering for righteousness and suffering for sin. He says, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you, falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad. Why? Because great is your reward in heaven. So how much of a pull is that for us? You again see here where patience fits. Patience and trust in the promises of God is the only thing that will sustain us. This also brings us to the whole subject of what really is valuable to us. If temporary happiness and comfort are our value, we're going to be in real trouble. But if the eternal God-given reward that's promised to us is our focus, then patience will be our natural response. So how do you live in this truth? Well, you whistle in the dark. Now, you know what that means? When I was a little boy, junior high, And junior hires aren't little boys, but I felt like a very little boy because I worked in this huge warehouse all by myself. And I cleaned it. And it was an old brewery, the old ABC brewery in San Diego. And it went blocks. And I would sweep it out and clean it out. And I was all by myself. And I can't tell you what a scary place that was. And the old bats where they put the stuff, if you wanted to kill somebody and hide the body, perfect place. And you know what I used to do? I used to whistle the song Over the Rainbow. You know that song? And that's what kind of kept me going in the dark. Now, would the whistling of that song kept anybody away who was going to try to harm me?
No.
And that's what I mean by whistling in the dark. And a lot of Christians are living like that. Is it just pie in the sky by and by, as we used to say? Matthew 5:12 says, we're in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. So what can we learn from the prophets? As an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Well, how about Moses? Let's look at him. He endured rejection of Pharaoh through the plagues and stiff-necked, rebellious people, and yet he trusted God. And he said, if your presence does not go with us, they'll send us up from here. What did patience look like in Moses' life? He loved being with God. And nothing that kept him from that would be allowed. Take David, for example. He was pursued by Saul, falsely accused, and yet he waited for God's timing and deliverance. Elisha, attacked by Ahab and Jezebel. He found God faithful. Jeremiah, who was called the weeping prophet, he claimed God's promise. God said to him, get yourself ready, Jeremiah. Stand up and say to these people whatever I command you. Do not be terrified by them, or I will terrify you before them. Today, I have made you a fortified city, an iron pillar, a bronze wall to stand against the whole land. They will fight against you, Jeremiah, but you will not be overcome. For I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord. Elisha, who was attacked by Ahab and Jezebel, found God faithful. Jeremiah, who was called the weeping prophet, claimed the promises of God. And so many more in Hebrews 11:32 to 40, it says, and what more can I say? I don't have time to tell you about Gideon and Barak and Samson and Japheth, and he goes on with some more, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, gained what was promised. Some faced jeers and floggings and chains and imprisonment and destitute, persecuted and mistreated. They were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what God had promised, since God had planned something better for them, that only together with us would be made perfect. So what's he saying? All the promises of God are future. And they're not here, they're there. Oh, we see vestiges of them here. James 5 says, as you know, we count as blessing those who have been patient, persevere. You have heard of Job's perseverance and have seen what the Lord finally brought about. And so Job says, my eyes heard of you, but now my ears have seen you. I know that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. Now let me just stop. Do we, without question, really believe that? Can you absolutely say that no purpose of God can be thwarted? The Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the first. But you know what was Job's greatest blessing? Not that God restored everything at the end, but that he came to really know what it was to walk with God in the midst of trial. So what sustained Job? Well, listen, these were some of his words. The Lord gave, the Lord takes away, blessed be the name of the Lord. Another one. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Now, do we really believe this? When we go through trial, has God a greater blessing in mind for me? Yes. Luke 6:22-23. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject you, your name is evil, because of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, because great is your reward in heaven. 1 Peter 4:14. If you're insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. So he says then what? Walk worthy of your calling. Be completely humble, gentle, meek, and patient. Now last week I shared with you the story of the swan and the crane. Let me just review it a minute, and then I want to play a song for you that really captures this. The swan came from heaven, and he was talking about heaven to the crane. And the crane was there in the mud looking for snails. Remember? And so the swan started talking about how wonderful heaven was. And he asked the crane, he said, "Do you know anything about heaven?" He said, "Nah." And so he began to explain all of this. And the crane finally said, "You know, you can keep your heaven. I just want more snails." And that's where many of us are living. We want more dollars, more popularity, more health, more whatever it is. More snails. So listen to this song. See if you agree with its song, with its truth.
Be one.
So you really believe that? You see, if it really is worth it all, then I can be patient. Because what I'm looking for isn't here. It's there. It changes everything. You see, patience can really be summarized in one phrase. Submitting to God's timetable. And that's in the big scheme of things, as well as in the little scheme of things. So if God is in charge of everything, is he in charge of the slow driver in front of you on the freeway? Is he in charge of the clerk that seems like they checked out before you ever got there? I mean, this is very practical. If I really believe that God is in charge of everything, including time, then I can rest in him. And ultimately, in the absolute big things, I can trust him because it will be worth it all. So this is what patient is. You're going to walk worthy of the Lord. What does it mean? It means you're going to be completely humble. It means you're going to be meek, gentle. It means you're going to be patient. That's the picture. So how do we measure up on the scale? Heavenly Father, I'm really thankful that it will be worth it all. In a sense, it would be great to hear for those who've gone ahead of us to yell back to us, hey, it's great up here. But you've already told us in Jesus Christ, he's come to tell us what eternity with you is going to be like. Book of Revelation, so many other places explain that to us. I pray that you'd forgive us for our impatience because we think we're in charge, we need to be in charge, things need to move at our pace. Thank you for the wonderful gift. It is a fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, and the rest. And Lord, I pray that you might help us to long for it. That we would be people who would repent of our impatience. That we would say, God, we want you to root it out of us. And that people would look at us and say, how could you be so patient? And their answer could be, I'm waiting on God's perfect timetable. I thank you that I can say to a person like Donna Franklin yesterday morning that it would be worth it all. That to see your face will make everything right. So I pray as we leave this place that you'd make these things real to us. That we'd realize that true patience comes as we learn to trust you implicitly in your timing. And I pray that as we give ourselves to that, we'd become people that are known to be completely humble, meek and gentle, and patient. And we'll thank you because we ask it in Jesus' name.